So I'll call upon Dr. Milind Chaudhary to speak to us about the role of ring fixators in reconstruction.
Thank you, Mangal. Thank you, Mr. Ram Prabhu and Bombay Orthopedic Society for kindly inviting me. So we are turning full circle now. Before you lay down a wreath and say that the circular or the ring fixator is dead, you must reconsider the wonderful uses that it can be put to. Once upon a time, 25 years ago, young surgeons started with circular fixation with more of these circles in sight, this ambition, this goal. Very soon to realize that what it takes is more of a Herculean effort needed to reach these levels, Olympian levels. However, with a period of time, we come to know that Archimedes told us, give me a lever long enough and I can move the world. Elizarov told us, give me a hinge and a circular fixator and I can correct any deformity in the world. So from Kurgan, Siberia, Professor Elizarov gave us the law of tension stress. He gave us the 7 golden rules of lengthening, which are these, which all the young surgeons should know and read Clinical Orthopedics and Related Research, volume 230 and 231. And here are not only the rules, biological principles. So far, we have been speaking about fixators and hardware. We have spoken about small fixators. We have spoken about plates as fixators. We have spoken about different kinds of hardware. What we need to understand is that the Elizarov came with the baggage of software. It gave us principles, the biological rules, and the rules for deformity correction. And just to reiterate some of those, very brief recap of the rules that the Elizarov fixator came with. To use a standardized deformity model, when you have a deformity like this, and the transverse bisector line is the axis of correction, by placing the hinges, you can either do a closing wedge osteotomy, or you can perform an opening wedge osteotomy. If you place it on the convex side, lengthen a triangle of bone, correct the deformity. If you want lengthening as well, you place it away from the convex cortex to achieve length and correction. If you can't perform the osteotomy exactly at the apex, you keep the hinge at the right level, but perform the osteotomy where it is possible and expedient. And similarly, you can achieve either a combination of length and deformity correction using all these methods. So let's look at the broad variety of things that you can do with the circular external fixator. The Elizarov is indeed a universal fixator. A young child with congenital femoral deficiency can be safely lengthened to 5 centimeters. Watch his father performing a hinged knee movement very carefully every day. And at the end of it, he has a thin rod that is put in to prevent refractures and full range of motion. He then goes on to get a circular fixator to lengthen his tibia by 7 centimeters with fully retained function in both the joints. Or a young achondroplastic dwarf like this starts treatment at the age of 4 years, get 11 centimeters in her tibia, lengthens her humeri to restore the upper and lower body proportions, and then again gets a cross lengthening so that by the time she is 22 years of age, she is now 4'10" and she's married the person, she's met the love of her life, and she leads life not as an achondroplastic dwarf who's ostracized in society, smiled at, laughed, sniggered at, but as someone who leads a life of love and respect. You take any deformities like these, however grotesque they may be valgus, combination of valgus, varus recurvatum, internal rotation and shortening, we can apply the appropriate hinges regardless of where the deformity is, how severe it is. We can place the hinges, place the minimally invasive fixator in a variety of manners. It's not only the wires, but also the half pins in various configurations. So what we have is the ultimate jig. We can use it in any circumstance to correct the deformity, to achieve the length, and achieve whatever is needed to be done in that particular case without compromise. So a very distal tibial valgus like this, and we can use the hinges and the motor rods, which are perpendicular to the side of the osteotomy, and correct it and achieve the required translation as well. So you can get length, angulation, rotation, and translation. Suppose, let's come to varus deformities in this child. You don't need to create expensive jigs. The Elizarov fixator is the ultimate jig. You can angulate and translate, correct her deformities. What about growth arrest in children? A severe varus like this, you need to resect the physeal bar. So you remove a triangle of bone, get down to the physeal bar, resect it, apply the Elizarov fixator, and through the site of that osteotomy, perform the lengthening and also through a site above to achieve the desired result, along with overcorrection and over lengthening to compensate for future deformity and shortening. Varus deformity is leading to medial compartment osteoarthritis. When combined with internal rotation, are very nicely dealt with by the circular fixator. Here, you can not only correct the varus, correct the patient's leg into external rotation, translate the distal fragment laterally to give a very happy result and freedom from pain. If the deformity is significantly larger, as in this case, and we find that the deformity is also present in the joint, then we can perform a double osteotomy, one of which is an L-shaped intra-articular osteotomy like so, and the second one is just below it and fixed it with the Elizaro fixator in this manner. It gives us endless possibilities, and you can see she has very good correction of her mechanical axis and is completely free from pain and the mediolateral toggle of osteoarthritis. What if you have something as dramatic as this? Blount's disease, though not common in India, this can be really troublesome as an understatement. And here again, we can perform a hemiplateau elevation as well as a distal metafacial osteotomy to give the perfect correction that is needed for this child. Despite the obesity, despite the complexity of that and magnitude of the deformity, the circular fixator will never fail you. What if you have varus recurvatum internal rotation and shortening? You can use the Elizaro, first perform the angular correction along with lengthening. When the rings become parallel, you can set in a derotation assembly and gradually derotate the limb to the desired extent. The hardware that is used is not expensive. It requires a little bit of an effort. It requires grooming a team. It requires having time, a specific days of the week that you keep for these patients to come in your very busy practice so that you can be aligned, your radiology technician, your Elizarov technicians, and you must have time to give them to see what needs to be done next. You can have a very distal tibial varus as in this medical student with a growth arrest, and you can see the motors are angled. You have the ability to angle the motors, to place the hinges, to angle the motors, to perform percutaneous corticotomies at any level in the bone to achieve lengthening or deformity correction. You can see the very dramatic foot deformity that can also be corrected by this method that we call as the kinesiological correction, by accurately placing the motors so that the talus slides into the ankle joint, is not over distracted, not crushed, and not subluxed. This is a method which is the Ponseti's application, which we call the kinesiological correction, like so, to give her a good dorsiflexion as well, even at this age. You can correct dysplasias in the hip. This is a young student who came to us with AVN. Look at this Trendelenburg sign. We performed a medial displacement osteotomy, lengthened the distal frag at the lower level, translated the distal fragment laterally to normalize his axis. The lurch is gone. 24 years down the line, he's got full range of motion, a very well-aligned axis, and equal leg lengths. What about sagittal plane? This is poliomyelitis. This is a fixed flexion deformity, which is very disabling. This is a pharmacist from USA, from Cupertino, and she has this Elizaro supracondylar with a percutaneous osteotomy. The Elizaro fixator is the ultimate jig. You can correct all 360 degrees because the circle, coming full circle, the shape of the limb is circular, and hence you can place the hinges and you can correct the deformity. And forget about discomfort. This is the simple method we have discovered by which they can do CPM and enjoy their time as well. This is the swing CPM. And it ensures, you know, I'm a Gujarati, I'm from Ahmedabad. I was born in Ahmedabad, and we have swings everywhere, I'm sure you agree. And we can put our swings to good use. So here she is with very good range of motion, full correction of her fixed flexion deformity, which is very nice. What about recurvatum, the most disabling deformity? So here we translate the distal fragment anteriorly. This is rule 2. The deformity is present in the joint, but the osteotomy is performed at the suprapatellar level. So therefore, there is some necessary translation, as I showed in the animations. So then why is not the Elizarov universal? Because a lot of us don't know how to prevent knee stiffness. We do not have the time, the gumption, the wherewithal, or the inclination to adjust the fixator in the post-op period. And we are scared, and so are our patients, of the prolonged duration. But there are answers. You can prevent knee stiffness by passing in the pins posterior to the quadriceps and making sure you put the knee through full range of motion on the table. These are things you can do very easily. And so, even with a very low osteotomy, which heals in less than 2 months, this lady can, with pins which are very close to the knee joint, this lady can have full range of motion. The pain and comfort, this is very important. We treat children as young as 15 months of age with the Elizaro. We can have carbon fiber rings, titanium pins, which makes it all very light. The first task of the young surgeon is to learn how to keep the patient free from pain. If you can do that, you can treat them at all ages. And it's a simple art. It takes a little bit of discipline. The evening of the surgery, the frame must be attended to. The next morning, before the patient is taken out of bed and mobilized, you must take bend down on the bedside and make sure that the fixator is stable and watch for any signs of pain, which you do not correct with your pen and injection diclofenac. You go down with your spanners and rectify the cause. If there's skin tenting, you go down and release immediately. Whether it's the humerus or the femur, you know, the patients must remain free from pain. However, the solution can come from technology. The Taylor Spatial Frame Fixator gives us the ability to perform the secondary corrections with the help of software. This is the head of the Department of Medicine. He has got a malunion leading to medial compartment arthritis, shortening varus internal rotation. So we can't compromise. We need to give him a good long-term result. So we put on the TSF fixator. We program it with a high fibular osteotomy. And mind you well, don't for even a moment think that your proximal fibular osteotomy is going to do the job by itself. You have to do the thorough job. You have to correct the varus rotation as well as give him length. And you're so happy that he's back at work and he could even do his Swedish exercises as he proudly pointed out to us. So here's a gentleman who works at Infosys. I don't know why he retained this deformity for so long. Very significant contracture at the wrist, shortening of the radius, rather complex. You can program the Taylor spatial frame, first correct the soft tissue contracture with the Elizarov hinges, then program the TSF fixator with a distal radial osteotomy after the wrist contracture is corrected to bring the radius out to length like this. This is the original six axis, and here he is gradually correcting with his wrist and fingers, wrist and DRUJ completely corrected. What if you have an ulnar club hand with a proximally migrated radius and a bowed ulna? You can lengthen his, you can perform an percutaneous osteotomy of the radius, lengthen the ulna, and also program the fixator to translate the radial head a little bit closer to the ulna towards the end after lengthening 7 centimeters for him to achieve perfect congruence of the proximal radio ulna joint. The next step is to use the fixator to add internal fixation to reduce fixator duration. Here is a child who's a daughter of a general surgeon. According to him, the first young lady, female, born in that small little ethnic group over the first 200 years, precious child, growth arrest, shortening. So we put in a fixator-assisted nailing. All the principles are used, medial translation in the femur, some length in the femur, 3 centimeters. Fixator comes out quickly. The Elizarov circular fixator is very well tolerated in the tibia, and it can do the job of lengthening varus correction as well as rotation. All the hardware comes out rather quickly. Knee range of motion comes back soon. Something like this, a dramatic deformity, a fixator on the femur would certainly take much longer to heal. So we do perform fixator-assisted nailing, which is a topic dear to our hearts in the last 20 years now, so that the fixator can be done away with. However, the circular fixator is still wonderful in the tibia, and it does the job for us to get a result like this. Finally, we take a look at fixator-assisted plating. Hotshot businessman, drives a Mercedes, doesn't want a fixator, has got a large deformity. So what do we do? He's got some shortening. He says, I don't care about a centimeter of shortening. So we do fixator-assisted plating. We put on the TSF fixator on the table. We do the calculations with the help of the fixator and then go in and put in a medial tomofix plate. He comes out. He can attend to his business within 2 weeks. And here he's rewarded with a very good result with the acceptable compromise of a little bit of shortening. Or take a look at a young adolescent, plump young girl who is the apple of her father's eye. She's got the significant genu valgum. You don't need to print specific jigs. You can use the Elizarov or the TSF fixator on the table. Keep the rings open laterally. perform a dome osteotomy. There is a recent paper read where you resect a triangular wedge and you put in a plate. But that shortens the limb. And if it's bilateral, you're going to create shortening. If you perform a dome osteotomy, then you do not have shortening. You can do the appropriate translations, use the best plates, and they mobilize really quickly. I will end with, you can also perform shortening. Lady from England comes to me with a cosmetic lengthening gone bad. She's got some length, horrendous deformities. We analyze the oblique plane deformity. She's given me a task. Make my tibia straight and make it exactly 12 millimeters longer than the opposite tibia. Lot of calculations can be done. The circle is a natural, perfect, and geometric shape which responds to the laws of nature and mathematics. The rule that tells us the length of the chord of a circle is 2 pi r alpha divided by 360. It boils down to r alpha divided by 57. R is the radius. That can be the diameter of the bone, or it can be the distance from the structure at risk to the convex cortex, and it tells us how much to resect. Now, this is a rare case, but we do this frequently in cerebral palsy, where we have a fixed flexion deformity in an adolescent. We need to get rid of the FFD by performing a supracondylar osteotomy with shortening. Lengthening the hamstrings can be risky, bone shortening is not. So the same principle is used. We know how much to shorten the concave cortex, we know how much to shorten the convex cortex. So the circle is the ultimate natural tool which helps us to correct. So this lady went on to get her perfect correction both in the tibia and in the femur to the desired extent, all because the circular external fixator allows us to perform each and every task to the desired extent. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Milind. So, we've kind of gone up from the morning in, a little bit of complexity, starting with straightforward trauma, relatively straightforward fixators to increased, increasingly complex indications. And what you saw now was stuff which cannot be dealt with by anything else. Much of the stuff that you saw in his presentation can only be dealt with a ring fixator. And with the use of the ring is now coming up the use of six axis, which you saw, he showed you the TSF. So definitely there is, not everybody can use ring fixators, but that's a role, I think, which is not going to go away for a long time. The role of ring fixators in trauma, in orthopedics is definitely
with
continuing and
with
increasing.
With your permission, I would like to say that the young residents in teaching hospitals in Mumbai should. There are very few government hospitals and teaching hospitals in India where the residents are encouraged to do the Ilizaro. I know of one such, which over the years, I know you are at JJ and you do encourage and you do teach the kids really big time, is Assam Medical College at Dibrugarh. Over the last 25 years, consistently they are doing. At Madras Medical College, Dr. Govardhan used to do. You are doing it at JJ. I would really invite all of the seniors to indeed encourage their youngsters, because the utility of this is universal and the components are reusable. It's not expensive. All it needs is a little thought and some time and some labor.
So, questions?
One comment, if I may. Milind is not a true Ahmedabadi. True Ahmedabadis don't do external fixator, they do TKR. Second, somehow micromotion was not addressed.
Just answer that.
Micromotion, see, before I got my first CM, for the first 5 years, I treated at least 300 fractures of the tibia with the Ilizaro fixator. At that time, we weren't using half pins, we were using wires. Now, axial micromotion is known to be beneficial. Without a doubt, shearing forces are detrimental to fracture healing, bending forces are detrimental to fracture healing. Axial micromotion is beneficial. If you use stainless steel half pins, they have very high stiffness and they do not permit any kind of micromotion at the fracture or the osteotomy site. However, stability is the first principle of importance in lengthening, etc. But where it comes to fractures, even today we use all wire frames. And those are really beneficial because there is a trampoline-like effect and you tension them just enough so that when the patient walks, the shearing, bending and rotational forces are taken care of, and the apparatus is only three struts in fracture, in fracture treatment, and it does allow a certain micromotion at the fracture site. Now, people have implanted sensors and they have found this, and they have found this to be beneficial. People have used a lot of high technology to replicate what Elizarov does at very low cost and very great convenience. So you can dynamize, you know, get rid of more pins, get rid of some of the struts, and that allows more micromotion as the healing progresses. And that is indeed very important. But most of all, walking is. Firstly, no patient can be ever in bed for more than a day when you put on the fixator. And there are lots of tricks to learn. You know, if the femur fixator people are scared, you have to modify the beds, learn, teach them how to lie down prone, teach them how to sit, how not to sit. It's not that difficult. It's not rocket science.
Yeah, it just needs mind space. You have to set your mind to it.
Go yeah, I already said that. thank you. The reason I'm not nitpicking here, my residents at the back of the room understand one micromotion. Thank you for making it. There would be distraction, bad. Angulation, flexural, bad. Torsional, worst. Axial loading, micromotion, cyclical loading, intramedullary nailing, locking, dynamizing, weight bearing. It is very poorly appreciated. Forget understanding that axial loading is possible in a ring fixator frame. With respect, Dr. Chandak. Nobody should leave this room with the idea that it is possible to get axial loading micromotion in a spanned fracture, fresh, ununited, infected, or otherwise.
Spanned as in? With a conventional
spanned
fixator?
As in bridged, gapped. Any kind of fixation,
gap.
Specifically plate. If you are going to further, if I may, relative stability, rigidity, initially AO, stability provides for no movement. The only micromotion demonstrated to enhance fracture healing is axial loading compressive micromotion.
Yes.
Any fixator assembly, internal, external, which provides for any other motion, macro or otherwise, apart from axial compressive, is not micromotion.
Yeah. But the thing is, everything allows for axial micromotion. Even a plate will allow for axial micromotion. Unilateral fixator will allow for axial micromotion. But the problem is that in varying amounts, they are accompanied by, you know, cantilever loading and therefore angular mobility. The Elizarov, by way of its I-beam, can give pure axial micromotion. So when push comes to shove in very difficult situations, it's always a good idea to use an all-wire frame that he talked about, because then you have pure micromotion
healthy,
in the axial direction.
A healthy compromise is to use titanium half pins.
Yeah.
Because half pins are more, and titanium is definitely more flexible, elastic, and it will retain these properties.
No, but even then, if you have a patient who's come to you with, you know, three surgeries done and you need to get him healed, you would probably ensure that you put in all wires if you can in that, right?
Very often, very often.
And if, see, the whole reason for being here today is axial loading micromotion enhances fracture healing. One is the ring fixator provides for it.
Yeah.
Two is it is absurd to suggest rigid and or stable fixation, plate fixation. Plate fixation would permit for axial compressive
micromotion. That's true,
micromotion.
Yeah, but plate also allows for healing.
Permits for healing by relative stability, no movement.
But
there is no micromotion, sir.
I know. I agree. But see, what we are talking about to a certain extent is not, we are not, he uses plates. I use plates. All of us use plates. So we are not saying that, Elizarov is the best or the fixator is the best. What we are saying essentially is that there is definitely a place for fixators. So don't go, you know, thinking that modern equals a yellow titanium locking plate. Fixators are as modern, and he just showed you one example of the TSF, which is computer controlled and stuff like that.
Possibly I'm not being clear enough. I am just saying that we should not be mucking around with the meaning of the term micromotion.
That's right.
Okay.